to do something like this. Let me ask you, how far are you willing to go to save somebody? How far are you willing to go to let somebody know that the love of God can also reach out to them? Amen?
Amen.
As we go through our culture, the culture of the church, we've been through the first element, which is love. Last week we went through empowerment, and today we're touching on the subject of grace. And I've entitled the message, Grace Wins. Somebody say, Grace Wins.
Grace Wins.
When we look at grace, and I think grace, the grace message has become very popular over the last almost couple of years. But the truth of the matter is, grace is not like a New Testament thing. Amen. Oftentimes when we talk about grace, we focus on the New Testament. But the truth of the matter is, when you look through the pages of the scriptures, grace has always been there. Just like when you go through the pages of the Bible, the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, has always been behind the scenes. Amen? God loved his son so much that he allowed him to come and die for you and I. To the point where he was hated by the very ones that were actually supposed to be receiving him, the Pharisees. Because Jesus was not holy enough. He was not religious enough. Why? Because at one point he did not keep the Sabbath as a result of him healing somebody as a result of grace. He was not holy enough. So the Pharisees were constantly on him. He was not holy enough as a result of that. They said things like, he heals the sick, he performs miracles by sin. Amen? He was not intolerant enough at one point where he had to deal with an adulterous woman. Whereas there were other people that were willing to stone this woman. He was not legalistic enough. Because today, sometimes when we go through certain churches, you know, the churches are just filled with a bunch of rules and regulations, what you can and cannot do, instead of living according to the grace or seeing through the lens of the grace of God. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus was not demanding enough. Because if he was, then he would demand for every person that he actually helped and healed to follow him, but he gave them a choice. That is the grace of God. And I think sometimes the world out there needs to understand and know. And they can only experience that grace of God through our lifestyle. So when we say as a church that we practice a leg culture, we practice grace, that grace of God must be seen and must be reflected through you. Amen?
Amen.
When you go back to the garden where the grace was first exemplified, God told Adam and Eve not to eat that fruit, and they ate that fruit. And after man sinned, what happened? They hid away. They were hiding away from God. But what did God do? God shows up in the cool of the day and said, where are you? Man is hiding. See, even when in our darkest moments, when we are hiding from God, God is still in pursuit. God is still in search of us. Paul puts it this way. He still loved us while we were what? Yet sinners. That is the grace of God. So God has constantly been searching for man, because the Bible makes it clear that God has created us for himself, for his own pleasure. So it doesn't matter how far you go. You go through the book of Psalms, then he repeats the same thing, and God gives a revelation to David and says, even when I make my bed in hell, you are still with me. That speaks to the grace of God. Are you with me? But sometimes we, as legalistic people, holier than thou, we are quick to write people off. So my question is, do you extend the same level of grace that God has extended to you to other people? Amen?
Amen.
Somebody say, grace wins.
Grace wins.
See, the love of God, the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. He said, whosoever. That love triggered grace. So grace is the work of the love of God being exemplified to us. Amen? And when we have Bible study on Wednesday, Ebony O'Neill asked the question, what does grace mean? Grace simply means unmerited favor. And that's where, oftentimes, that's where we usually leave it at. Grace is unmerited favor. That means God giving you something that you do not deserve. But let me add to it, it's also God not giving you what you deserve. Amen?
Amen.
Because really and truly, if God were to give us what we deserve, we would not be here. Because the Bible says, for the wages of sin is what? Death. That means the moment we sin, we die. Amen? So sometimes the grace of God is so great that even though we may mess up, God still believes, again, going back to valuing people, God still has so much trust and belief in you that someday you're going to turn things around. He trusts you enough for you to turn things around. See, some of you right now, I know I'm sure you're trying so hard to be accepted in various areas of your life, whether it's in your family, whether it's on your job, whether it's in a relationship. And that's my friend, we try so hard when it comes to relationship. Especially the person when it comes to a female and a man trying to, whether it's dating or in a marriage context, a man and a husband and a wife. We try so hard to be accepted. Amen? But when it comes to God, you don't have to do that. Amen? He says, come as you are. You don't have to try so hard. And again, this is where religion comes in. Because when you go to certain areas or certain religions, it's like you have to do certain things. Like the Muslims say, you have to do certain things. And eventually, when you get to heaven, you have 72 virgins and all these other things that you have to do. You have to earn. It's like you have to do something to earn God's approval. You have to do something to earn God's acceptance. No, you don't have to do any of that. So what am I saying? I'm saved, I can still live the way I live. No, that's not what I'm saying. See, the grace of God must move you from a place of understanding and honoring that grace. Amen?
Amen.
It's like, you know what, let me just give an analogy here. Lady T, come real quick. Vita, come. I really want this to just stick in your head. Come. Everybody knows who she is, right? Who is she? Who is she? She's my wife, right? Good. We're gonna do a little skit, okay? So I'm not an actor. We're going to try and do a little quick acting. Hey, honey, how was your day? Yeah, how are the kids? You know I love you, right? Yeah, how you doing? Oh, I love my mistress. Aren't you glad? Feeling good today?
Yeah, where have you been lately? I haven't seen a lot of you lately.
Oh, I've been around.
Really?
Yeah.
Doing what?
Oh, just busy, you know.
Yeah, doing what? No, I don't like that answer. I know you very well. It doesn't sound convincing to me.
Okay, you know what? I must confess. I'm cheating. It's just bothering me. I can't hedge.
Excuse me? No, come again?
I'm not supposed to be laughing.
No, come again?
You heard me right. I can't repeat that. It hurts so bad, but I can't. It's just
burning. It hurts you so bad? How do you think I feel? To really think about it. I have to go consult with God and really think about it. I have to pray and ask God, I need some healing myself first, but I know that God would want me to do that, but it's just going to take some time.
Okay, you do that. So the weekend is here. You want to go?
Wherever you want to go.
Okay, and after, so you go to the movies, and the movies, where?
Everywhere.
Go to your house.
I'm great. Oh, so just to let you know, I've been really praying and God's been revealing some stuff to me about what you've been really doing. I mean, you told me that you were cheating on me, and I really felt in my heart that it was sincere and that you were finished, you know, cheating on me. But God revealed himself to me, telling me that you're still cheating on me. Yes, he did. God speaks to me. I hope he's been speaking to you too. I think you need to go on your knees and pray and ask him to help you. He is a forgiving God, you know. He is a very, I mean, I'm sure you should know that you do call yourself a pastor, right? So you should know that, right? But you know, we all have sinned and fallen short. And you know, God gives us grace. So as your wife as well, I mean, I know what you've done has hurt me, and I know you continue to do what you do, but I'm praying. I'm really praying for you. I'm really praying for you.
It's just really good. I appreciate that. I wasn't expecting for you to pray for me. Thank you.
Well, that's what Jesus would do for us, right?
He's supposed to cry.
I know. That's what the devil would want, okay? Flesh.
Then the following week, hey, Vita, I had a wonderful time. It was amazing.
Oh, really?
I think we should take it to the next level. What do you
think? Wow. Oh,
totally, sure. So,
oh, God.
Maybe go to Vegas or something.
How much more can I bear? Oh, Jesus. Help me, Father. Jesus, help Pastor Dom, oh, God. Help him, oh, God. Remove every temptation, Lord God, from his life, Almighty God. Wherever I've gone wrong as a wife, help me, Jesus. Help me, Lord.
Hey, honey, I'm home.
Jesus.
What's up?
No, I'm not happy today.
Oh, whoa.
No, no, no.
What's going on?
I just said, God has been really, I've been really spending a lot of time in God. I've been really fasting and praying for you. I've been really fasting and praying for you, and God has shown me more and more. You keep lying to me. You keep lying.
This is the end of our skit. The picture that I'm trying to paint here is that we as human beings, over and over again, we go to God, we hurt him, he comes looking for us, we ask for forgiveness, we go back and forth. The only difference is, it has to get to a point where, based on the fact that Lady T has the willingness to take me back and forgive me, a change must happen in my heart and say, you know what? What I'm doing to this woman is wrong, and I must change. So you don't serve God, you don't get saved out of the fear of God. You know what I'm saying? You don't get saved just because, oh, I'm afraid I'm going to go to hell. Grace must cause you to get to a place to understand that, you know what? This God loved me so much that he gave something that was so valuable to him. And he keeps coming back. And as even though I keep messing up, it has to get to a point where I say, you know what? God, I surrender. I cannot live like this anymore. So that is where salvation begins. That is where, by his grace, we are saved. And once you are saved, that's where it starts. And God, okay, I must start doing something better. So that's why you don't come to God and say, okay, there are people who say, oh, I have to come and get my act together, get everything right before I come to God. No. The transformation starts once you step into the grace of God. Amen?
Amen.
You don't try to change before, and that's why I keep saying, don't stop judging people by how they look, because on the outward it may look good. But the transformation starts within the heart. Amen. So once you know how much God loves you, the Apostle Paul would say, should we then continue to sin because grace abounds? No. God forbid. So if you understand how much God, so some of us, you know, came here this morning, well, we have come to give God thanks and praise. Why? Because he's been good to us all week long, right? So why don't you take it the next step further and say, okay, God, you've done so much for me. You've taken care of my family. Now you have a purpose for me. By your grace, I know through your grace, eventually, someday I will get it right. And you start taking that, making that step and walking with God. Amen. Are you with me?
Amen.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So you don't get saved out of the fear that you're going to go to hell. And don't get me wrong. People need to know that there is still hell. I mean, if you don't get your act together, you will end up there. But you need to understand why you're following God out of grace, not out of fear. Amen. Are you with me?
Amen.
That is why here as a church, it's a place where misfits fit in. I know when we did a video, a few people commented on that. If you're looking for a place where you can fit in, you come as you are. We don't set a certain standard as to, okay, this is how you should be. I mean, you know, summertime is over, so everybody can, you know, you see me wearing suits and stuff like that, but you don't have to. It's cold, so when I wear a suit, I'm all right. But I can't wait for the springtime and summer to come again so I can wear my jeans and even wear some shorts and come to church. Amen? So you go, you know, see, when you get to a legalistic place, there are rules and regulations that you have to abide by, and there is no transformation happening, and all that we keep doing is we keep fixing the outward part. Now let's pick up on the ladies. You put the eyelashes and the makeup and all that stuff and you look great, but something is happening on the inside that needs the grace of God. Fellas, some of us, we go through some stuff, the things that we go through in our head, that we need the grace of God to redeem us.
Amen.
But we put on suit and tie and all that, make it seem like everything is okay. But deep down inside, we are sitting in church pews, but still going to hell. Because we don't understand the grace of God. Amen?
Amen.
So I'm going to give you a few things, you know, a few examples. Nothing deep or anything like that. I mean, we can have hundreds of grace examples, but I think I have about 12 things that you just take a note of here. I believe that grace opened doors to many things. I'm going to give you 12 of them. If you're taking notes, write down, grace tells the truth. Somebody say, grace tells the truth.
Grace tells the truth.
And if we can go to Matthew chapter 15. Matthew chapter 15. It's a long passage, but I'm going to try and see if I can stop somewhere once we get a gist of it. And I'll start reading. And it says, then came to Jesus scribes and Pharisees, which were of Jerusalem, saying, why do thy disciples transgress the tradition of the elders? The tradition of the elders. For they wash not their hands when they eat bread. But he answered and said to them, why do you also transgress the commandment of God of your tradition? For God commanded, saying, honor thy father and mother, and he that curseth father and mother, let him die the death. But ye say, whosoever shall say of his father and his mother, it is a gift, but whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me. And honor not his father and his mother shall be free. Thus have ye made the commandment of God of none effect by your tradition. Ye hypocrites. Well, did Isaiah the prophesy of you saying, This people draw nigh unto me with your mouth and honor me with your lips, but your heart is far from me, but in vain they worship me, teaching for doctrines and the commandments of them. And he called the multitude and said unto them, hear and understand, not that which goeth into the mouth defileth the man, but that which cometh out of the mouth that defileth the man. Then came his disciples and said unto him, knowest thou the Pharisees were offended after they heard this saying? But he answered and said, every plant which my father had not planted shall be rooted. Let's pause here for a second. So, again, going back to legalism, as to things and rules and regulations and traditions and things that you do, Jesus said it's not what you actually eat that defiles you, but what comes out. What he's referring to is that what's in your heart is very important. Because these people say that they worship God with your mouths, but in your hearts, it's a mess. Amen? And that's why he calls them hypocrites. You know, I'm convinced that if Jesus was the pastor of this church, or if Jesus was the pastor of many churches in our city or in North America, not a lot of people, so-called Christians, will attend this church. Because Jesus at times can be harsh. Amen? Because he is addressing the Pharisees. He's not addressing worldly people. Eh? He's addressing people who claim to know God. They know all the commandments and rules and the laws. Amen? Then the disciples came and said, "Oh, Pastor, the Pharisees were offended." He said, "Well, in contemporary terms, you probably say, I don't care if they were offended or not." And I think sometimes we do the same thing when we, you know, people come to church, the pastor says something, that's supposed to be convicting you. People get offended because the pastor said something. It's a place where you're supposed to be honest and sincere with yourself instead of just getting offended. And a lot of Christians, so-called Christians, they get offended very easily, which I think is terrible. Amen?
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 Amen.
Look at your neighbor and tell them, don't get offended. Don't let the spirit of offense get it. Come on, tell them.
Don't let the spirit of offense.
And he goes on to say, he said, every plan which my heavenly Father had not planted shall be uprooted. Again, that's why it's very important. Don't be quick to judge people who are in the church. Oh, Pastor, he looks like that. She looks like that. Did you know he did that? Did you know she did that? It's not my responsibility. Jesus said, allow the wheat and the tares to grow together until harvest. Let them come. Trust me. In the coming year, I'm convinced, I believe that God is sending a whole lot of people in the church. Again, they won't look like you. They won't talk like you. Open the doors. Open the floodgates. Let them come. Let them come. And wait until harvest and let God do his work.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
You can read the entire chapter when you get home. But let's go to verse 21. It says, then Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan, came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. But he answered her not a word, and his disciples came and besought him, saying, send her away, for she cried after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, it is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. And she said, truth, Lord, yet dogs eat the crumbs which fall from the master's table. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from the very hour. Amen?
Amen.
If you're taking notes, lesson number two, grace redeems. Somebody say grace redeems.
Grace redeems.
So it doesn't matter what your background looks like, where you come from, if you desire the master, you will redeem you. This was somebody who was not worthy of receiving what needed to be received because she was a Canaanite. He said, I don't give what belongs to the children to dogs. See, this is where a merited favor comes in. What you don't deserve, he can give you if your heart is turned towards him and you desire to seek him in spirit and in truth. And what happened there was worship. Amen? So when you come to church on a Sunday and you worship, again, it's a form of, or a symbolic of humility and saying, God, I surrender, I give it all to you, and I want you to take over my life. Amen? But that doesn't stop there. Amen? If you can go to John chapter 8. John chapter 8. So the first lesson is that grace tells the truth, grace redeems. And if we go to John chapter 8, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Bless you. John chapter 8. Most of you know the story, but we'll go through it real quick. Verse 1 to 11, and I read. Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again into the temple, and all the people came unto him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and the Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery, and when they had set her in the midst, they say unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Take note, you can underline this, in the very act. I always question this. How did they know Because fornication or adultery, the act of fornication or adultery, is not something that people do it in the open. I mean, except for the reprobates, okay? You do it in the open for everybody to see. But they said she was caught in the very act. So my question is, what were they doing there? Let's move on. Verse 5. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou? This they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground as though he hurt them not. So when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him be the first to cast a stone at her. Jesus is smart, you know. They said, we caught her in the very act. Well, if you are without sin, be the first to cast the stone. Because even if you were not doing anything and you saw what was going on, Jesus is the same person that said, if you look at the woman in your heart and perceive to have or sleep with him, you already committed the act. So he got them right there and then. Then verse 8, he said, again, he stooped down, he rolled on the ground, and they which heard it, being convicted by your own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last, and Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, Woman, where are those thy accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? She said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. So who are we to condemn people when they are here in the church? They don't look like us, don't talk like us, don't behave like us, and they need the grace of God. If you're taking notes, lesson number 3, grace covers. Somebody say grace covers. See, what happened here was, first, Jesus redeemed this woman from being stoned by these people according to the law. But even those accusers, Jesus covered them. Because Jesus could have called them out one by one, every single one of his sins. Amen? But he didn't. He said, if you are without sin, and I'm sure if somebody had said, okay, well, I had no sin, Jesus said, well, probably would have said, you are lying. You stole yesterday. You claim you gave your tithe the other day, but you only gave like a percent of it. It wasn't the full. Because these were the Pharisees. Jesus at one point said, you tithe even to the grain. You wear these long robes up to your knee, but your hearts are far away from me. Jesus could have called them out. But his grace went beyond even the person that they were condemning. So we need to understand the grace of God is so broad, and it reaches out to everybody. It doesn't matter who you are. So if sometimes, and as you grow in the faith, I used to pray certain prayers, and you know, sometimes you pray against people, but you don't pray against, you pray against the spirit behind what moves people, what causes people to do what they do. Amen? And even when we get to that point, the grace of God is still far greater to extend beyond any borders that human beings can put in place. Amen? Amen. Look at your neighbor and tell him, God hid your secrets too. Come on, tell him, say, He hid your secrets too. You see, we as a people, so every now and then, you see, when you've had like a closest friend or a good friend for a long time and you do something and it hurt them, the next thing you know, they start pulling all the bad things, all the nasty dirt on you, right? That's human nature. God will not do that to you. He said, "Love covers what? A multitude of sins," and that is being done through the grace of God. Jesus did not get into the detail of, "Oh, so which man were you sleeping with? Where were you? How many times have you done it? How many men have you done it with?" Jesus was not concerned about all of that. He said, I don't condemn you neither. Go now and sin no more. And sometimes that's what all our message needs to be. Just receive them with the love of Jesus Christ and let them know that the love of God is still waiting to receive them. Because I suppose that those who are sinning know that they are in sin. Because the Bible said when God created man, you know, from the beginning, man, he created man, he formed man from the dust of the earth, and after that he breathed into man, and man became a living soul. So that means the Spirit of God lives inside of you. So there is a spirit that lives inside of you that when you do something that is not in line with the Word of God, or not in line with the ordinances of God, your conscience tells you. That's what the Bible says here, that after Jesus asked them, if you are without sin, be the first to cast a stone, it will say they were actually tricked by their own conscience. Amen? So sometimes you don't even need to just tell people a whole bunch of scriptures to let people know that they are in the wrong or they are sinning. They know. Whether you are sick or not, you have the DNA of the Spirit of God. It's inside of you. Amen?
Amen.
Let's keep moving. So the first is grace tells the truth. Second, grace redeems. Three, grace covers. Number three, grace forgives. Somebody say grace forgives.
Grace.
Let's go to Luke chapter 5, 17 to 26. Luke chapter 5, verse 17 to 26, and I read. And it came to pass on a certain day as he was teaching, that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town in Galilee, in Judea, in Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. And behold, men brought in a bed a man which was taken with palsy, and they sought means to bring him in and to lay him before him. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in because of the multitude, they went upon the housetop and let him down through the tiling with his couch into the midst before Jesus. And when he saw their faith, he said unto him, Man, thy sins are forgiven thee. And the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, Who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answering said unto them, What reason ye in your hearts? Whether it's easier to say, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Rise up and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins, he said unto the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, arise and take up thy couch and go in thy house. Amen?
Amen.
Somebody say, grace forgives.
Grace forgives.
And I won't get into detail on this one because one of these days, hopefully before the end of the year, I will touch on the aspect of forgiveness, because this is another huge area that we as believers, we need to take grab a hold of, because unforgiveness can create a whole lot of things, even physically and literally to your body, causes cancer and diseases when you hold grudges and unforgiveness in your heart. Amen?
Amen?
And if you can just learn to forgive or be forgiven, it will bring healing to your body. Amen?
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 Amen.
The Word of God is light unto those who find them, and it brings help to your flesh. Amen?
Amen.
So Jesus said, is it easier for me to say your sins are forgiven? Sometimes that's all that we need to do. The grace of God is big enough, is great enough to forgive you of every and any sin. Amen? And people know. This week I reached out to one of our members that I haven't seen in years. Well, he hasn't been in church for quite a few years, but we just talked it. He's like, Pastor, I'm good, you know. God is still blessing me even though I've been unfaithful. Okay, they know. They know. The grace of God forgives. So if you found grace in the sight of God to receive forgiveness, why can't you forgive other people? They hurt you. They abused you. You just need to get to a place where you live past that. Because if you don't learn to forgive, it will eat you up. It will cause you a whole lot of sicknesses and diseases. And you will go to all-night prayer meetings and they will slam and smear a whole bunch of oils on you. You probably end up buying one of those holy waters that they sell and waste your money. Seriously, I'm very practical when it comes to the Word of God, because God has given us everything in this book. And sometimes all that we need to do is just be obedient to His Word and see God at work in our lives.
Amen?
Amen?
Amen.
You start forgiving people and you begin to see that cancer begin to shrink and disappear out of your body. Amen?
Amen.
go to bed at night, you can't sleep because you're thinking about all the things that they've done to you, the things that people who hurt you. But you come to church every day and ask God, God, please forgive me for what I've done. But you are still holding on to those that hurt you. And because he said, when you go before God, pray, he said, Father, forgive us as we forgive those who trespass against us. So if you're asking God to do that for you and that part is not done, I'm sorry, something is happening that you need to go check. It's killing you. It's creating sicknesses and disease in your body. And you cannot come to the same God and ask him for healing because he's already giving you the answer. You just refuse to act on it. Amen?
Amen?
Lesson number 5, grace restores. Somebody say grace restores.
Grace restores.
Look at your neighbor and tell him grace will restore you.
Grace.
Let's go to Luke chapter 15, verse 11. I know I'm going through quite a bit of scriptures today, but it's important because, again, I'm not speaking out of my own self. I think I need to make sure I give you the word of God. Amen?
Amen.
All right. I'm not Joel Osteen, just so you know. Luke chapter 15, 11 to 32. I probably won't go, you know what, maybe I'll just paraphrase the whole story. How many of you know the story about the prodigal son? Just wave to me if you know it.
Everybody.
We all know the story of prodigal son? Okay, for the sake of those who don't know, I'll just read through it quickly, but you can go home and read it as well. From 11 to 32. It says, and he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me, and he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country and sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger. Let me pause here for a second. Sometimes people may be in a situation where, you know, they've been led astray. But it's not just them. They are being led by the Spirit. The Bible says that when he came to himself, verse 17, and when he came to himself, what will cause someone to come to himself? It's either you are drunk, or you are possessed, or you are under some sort of a spell. Because you must know what you're doing. So from the time, my question is, so what really triggered and what possessed him in the beginning? Because this is not where the story starts. The story started from when he left the house. So at some point in the house, something happened. Was probably jealous, feeling a bit greedy. My dad has money. I need to take my portion and go spend it as I want. I don't want you to die before you get my inheritance. And sometimes that's how we behave. People out in the world, sometimes that's how they behave. God has given them all these giftings and wealth and knowledge and talents. And they go out and they just waste it. But it comes to a point. Everybody on the face of this earth at some point will come to himself or herself. Amen?
Amen?
And when that time comes, it's very important that we, the light of the world, are around to help. That's why the Bible says, no man comes unless they are led by the Spirit. He came to himself, and I believe that he received a revelation from the Holy Spirit. Amen? Verse 18 says, I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him. He had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Oh my goodness, this is amazing. See, sometimes that's how God treats us. Even though we've been gone way too long, his grace has always been there. In expectation and waiting to see us. He didn't wait for the son to get home. He ran off to give him a hug and kissed him on his neck. Is this the kind of love that we want people to experience in this church? Oh yes. So please, and this message is not, again, Every time we preach, you know, it sounds like, oh, this is for somebody, you know, mystical, who's going to show up one day and this message is for them. Maybe I'll preach them. No, this message is for you. Amen? Look at your man and tell them, this message is for you. So when people are walking in here, please, please, make every effort, and going back to that very word, be extremely intentional. I said intentional, but today I'm adding on to it. Be extremely intentional. Tell your neighbor, be extremely intentional.
Be extremely intentional.
People walk in here, take interest in them. Go out, just give them a hug. Love on them. And let your hug be authentic. Amen?
Amen.
If it's loosey-loosey, goosey, no feeling. I remember the first time I gave a friend, years ago, one of my friends, I gave him a hug. He's a guy in Milford. And I squeezed him. What's that? Because all this life, nobody has ever, not even his father, ever hugged him like that. I said, I love you. All for that? Yes. Make people feel the love. Amen? But I'm talking about a hug when it comes to men and women. You know, I think I've talked to you guys before. Lady Anderson, can we teach them properly? Because I know we're a church. I don't want people to take advantage of it. There is a holy hug, okay? Amen? Holy hug and kiss. The Bible talks about a holy kiss. Amen? So, if you ever see me, ladies, I do it this way. Fellas, see this one? Holy hug. It's not like, none of that. If you learn, it's a holy hug. I don't want anybody catching feelings. But let them feel it, okay? Let them feel it. Amen. It's the grace of God that restored this prodigal son into his father's house. And there are people out there that are searching. I'm so excited. I'm so super excited. I'm psyched about what God is about to do. Because I'm a shadow of a doubt. In the coming year, God is sending people in this house. This house is going to overflow. And I'm saying to myself, God, you better give me some strength and grace to be able to rent multiple services in here.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
But they are coming. They don't look like you. They may look like aliens. But you got to love them. Amen?
Amen?
Lesson number 6. Grace rebukes in love. Okay? Grace rebukes in love. So, you know, one of the things that a common thing I heard in the videos here, we don't judge, we don't judge, we don't judge, we don't judge. The Bible talks about judgment starts within the house of God. Here we will rebuke in love. So, if you come to this church and I see something and I tell you, don't take offense to it, I'm not judging you, I just love you, I just want the best for you. I'll rebuke you in love. Sometimes it may be harsh, sometimes too, it may be soft. Right? But I don't want you to take offense to it. Because the Bible says, he whom the Lord loves, he does what? He chastises. Amen? But be careful. It's all in how you do it. It's all in how you do it. Amen?
Amen.
So you go clubbing. You went clubbing last night. You showed up today and I smell some smoke and drinks on you. What are you doing here? That's random. What are you doing in a nightclub? What are you doing in church? Just go home. You know, is that a way to do it?
No.
That's random. You know very well this is not supposed to be. I don't understand why this is. Do you need my help? Anything I can do to help? Well, the next time you feel like just hanging with those people out in the world to go to the club, or you feel like you just call me up. You probably go for coffee, hang out, you know, go over to the movies, whatever. That place, you don't fit or belong to that place. It's all in how you do it. Remember, it's a journey for everyone. You were never like this when you got saved. Listen, if it wasn't for my spiritual father, Pastor Ransford, I remember the first time, and I think I shared this story before. So those of you who don't know, I used to rap, okay? And I was on national television on this Guinness Music Dancing for Your Dancing thing, whatever. So it's broadcast nationally at a club. And there I was, you know, with my wave cap on and everything. Saturday night, you know, I didn't leave the club till about 5 o'clock.
And I was in church, 10 o'clock for Sunday school. And after service, I saw people stretching their necks, people pointing to me, and that's him. What is this, man? But you know what my spiritual father did? He called me and he said, son, this is not good. You need to help me for me. See, I had a gift that I was using for the world. But he saw something and he was willing to help push it in a different direction. Amen. Before I started doing gospel music. See, those who were pointing fingers, if it wasn't for him, probably could have pushed me farther out. Because, you know, these guys don't want me here. And don't get me wrong, I love God. But it got to a place in my life where I was dealing with identity. And every one of us go through that every now and then in our lives. You struggle with where you are in your life and your identity and where God is, where God is calling you to. And you need people, like-minded people, that will help you, direct you in the right place. Amen?
Amen.
So what he did it in love versus the finger pointing. See the difference?
Amen.
So the grace of God, it rebukes and it does that in love. It also believes your future good. Somebody said, tell your neighbor, God believes in your future good. God cares about your future. Let's look at Peter. Peter was a murderer, a thug. When they were about to arrest Jesus, he pulled his knife and he cut off a soldier's ear, and Jesus kind of calmed him down. Jesus could have said, man, you're not supposed to be on my team. I'm God. I don't need murderers on my team. Oh my God, it blows my mind how Jesus operated. Jesus knew that Judas was a thief, but still he was in his camp. So as a church, do I expect that none of us will be perfect? Yes. We won't be perfect. And if people come and say, oh, so do you know so-and-so is this and this and that? Well noted. I'll be praying for him, and we'll be working it out. I'm not throwing you out of this house. Because as long as God still believes in your future, myself as an undershepherd, I still believe in your future.
Amen.
Because he said to him, upon this rock, I will build my church. Jesus, what do you mean? You want to build your church on somebody who's a murderer? See, that's the kind of belief that we should have in people. Believe in people. Value people. Because sometimes we judge people just on a superficial level, but just build a little bit of relationship and see what they got beneath. Right? When you walk on the surface of the ground, we work here in the city of Toronto, but it will amaze you the things that you can find underneath the surface. Some diamond, some gold, and we pass by it all the time because when we look at it, it's just ordinary dirt. But that's what God loves. God wants to take something that has no value, that the world sees as meaningless, and you want to create something great out of it.
Amen.
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 Look at your neighbor and tell him, God sees something great in you.
God
tell your other neighbor, God sees something great in you.
God sees
so don't waste your life.
Don't waste your life.
The grace of God is strong, is big enough, is large enough to see the good in you. God knew, Jesus knew that Peter would take this gospel to the rest of the world that you and I can benefit from. What if Jesus had said and told Peter, buddy, I'm supposed to go on the cross and you're going to cut a soldier's ear off? But I'm full. The Ghanaians understand what I say. Well, let me teach you another Ghanaian. Madamfu means my friend. Somebody say, Madamfu.
Madamfu.
It means my friend. You said, my friend, just get out of here. I need to get to the cross. Why are you trying to just stop my flow? But he saw the greatness in him. That to him, we will have the keys to the kingdom. Amen?
Amen.
And also grace, it unites. Somebody say grace unites.
Grace unites.
See, Jesus resurrects from the dead. And not only that, he sends a message for them to gather together. Because after Jesus was dead, everybody was kind of scattered. Jesus did not give up on them. He did not just get up and say, you know what, I'm just going to go to my Father. He made sure he brought the people back together again. Grace, it unites. that in here as a church, we need to get to a place, we need to learn, make every conscious effort, be extremely intentional about being united at all times. Amen? And as a church, how does that happen? And that happens through our gatherings, whether it's a church on a Sunday, Bible study, whether we have an event, whatever. It's so that we can be a close knit. We cannot do anything great if we are not together. And if the grace of God allows us to be together at all times, we need to exemplify that. Let's not just talk about it. Amen?
Amen.
Lesson number 9, grace isn't prejudice. This is a huge one. Grace isn't prejudice. Let's go to Luke chapter 10. Looks like we're reading Luke a lot today. Luke chapter 10, 25 to 37. Are you learning something today?
Yes.
Okay. Luke chapter 10, 25 to 37. Now read. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said unto him, What is written in the law? How readest thou? And he answered and said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all thy soul, with all your strength, and with all your might, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, Thou hast answered right, this do, and thou shalt live. But he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, And who is my neighbor? Somebody say, who's my neighbor?
Who is my neighbor?
And Jesus answered and said, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment. And wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance, there came down a certain priest that way. And when he saw him, he passed on the other side. Let's pause for a second. Sometimes, pastors, we call ourselves pastors, but somebody may need our help. But because they don't look like us, talk like us, we pass by in the guise of doing God's work. You know what I'm saying? So sometimes maybe somebody may need me on a Sunday that I need to make, it's very vital that I need to be there. But I may make the excuse that, oh, but I have to be in church on a Sunday to preach to the people. You have to determine which one is more important. Amen? First person was the pastor. 32, and likewise a Levite, the praise and worship leader, the praise and worship person, the people. Leaders, those that lead praise and worship in the house, the Levite. When he was at that place, came and looked on him and passed by on the other side. The pastor passed by, the Levite at least came to take a look. Oh, you're dying. Okay, I'll pray for you. He walks by. Sometimes that's what we do. When people need a hand, don't just say, I'm praying for you, whereas you actually have the power and the ability to be of support.
Amen.
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 I think I was sharing with the dream team, because we're preparing and trying to raise funds to go to Ghana next fall. And I was just asking the team, just go to your circle of influence and just ask people just to help. Right? And if you can't, if you have people in your life and you can't go to like 10 people to support you for something that is important to you, then something is wrong. If someone were to tell you, I don't have it, but I'll be praying for you. At least an effort needs to be made. Even if it's not what you're asking for, an effort needs to be made. Amen?
Yes.
Verse 23, and he said, A certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him. He was gracious. Samaritan. He's not a Jew. He's not churched. He's not a Christian. He's not a Catholic. He's not a Sabbath keeper. He's a heathen person, considered heathen. But he has the DNA of God, grace. He had compassion on him. And sometimes people in the world do better than us as Christians. Some people trust your worldly friends more than your Christian friends. And it's a shame, yes. It's a shame. And we need to do better. Amen?
Amen.
You don't do good unto only those that are good to you. You don't do good to only people that look like you. And I made this analogy the other day. I said, if let's say we went to, say, a basketball game, I was going to, like, say, a Raptors game by myself, and Pastor Randolph probably thought of having going to the game as well by himself. I sat there for a minute, and maybe during the halftime, I see him over there. He waves to me, "Hey, I didn't realize that you were here. What do I do?" The first instinct, because I know him, I move towards where he is. This is a natural tendency. You want to be around those that you're already familiar with. But in this season, I believe that we need to get outside of our comfort zone a little bit. Amen?
Amen.
Get outside of your comfort zone a little bit. And we will get there. As God brings in the people. Get outside of your comfort zone. And I've said this, when you come to church every Sunday, please don't look for the people that you talk to all the time. Find somebody else and talk to you. Somebody that you hardly talk to. Somebody you've never spoken to. Start building some relationship. Amen?
Amen.
It's not prejudice. I remember when I first came to Canada, people asked me today, "Oh, so you know this?" Especially when I meet Ghanaians who are from the States or somewhere else. "Oh, do you know this, so-and-so-and-so-and-so on this?" "Oh, they're Ghanaian." But I was intentional about it. I said, if God is calling me to reach out to a diverse group of people, and there's no better place to be to make that happen than in the city of Toronto, why should I limit myself to my own set group of people and just constantly be among Ghanaians? It's not kingdom-minded. It's just not kingdom. Amen? So get outside of yourselves. You're Jamaican, just interact with some Trinidadians, some Guyanese people. We have black people, interact with some white folk. I know it's hard to win them at times, but just as long as your love is genuine, eventually you'll come along. Amen?
Amen.
Are you with me?
Amen.
Lesson number 10, grace is good. Somebody say grace is good.
Grace is good.
Amen. Let's go to Luke 23. I'm still in Luke. Luke chapter 23. Some of you know the story, but reading from verse 32 to 43, I read, it says, "And there were also two other malefactors led with him to be put to death." This is talking about Jesus going on the cross. "And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, and there crucified him and the malefactors, one of the right hand and the other on the one on the other left. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And departed his raiment and cast lots. And the people stood beholding, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, He saved others, let him save himself, if he be Christ, the chosen of God. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar, and saying, If thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. And his superscription also was written over him, letters in Greek, Latin, also Hebrew, this is the king of the Jews. And one of the malefactors, or the thieves, which were hanged, railed on him, saying, If thou be Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answered, rebuked him, saying, Dost thou not fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive due reward of our deeds, but this man hath not done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today shall be with me in paradise. Somebody say, grace is good.
Grace is good.
So you mean to tell me somebody who's been sinning all his life, been stealing from people just because he acknowledged Jesus, God acknowledges him in his kingdom? Oh, yeah. See, when God extends his grace, all you need to do is just step in, and you're good. You don't have to do all kinds of things, and that's the problem. People try to work out things, and don't get me wrong. Your faith must produce some actions, because faith without works is what? Is dead. Salvation is free through grace. But when God opens that door of grace, you need to step in. So if you're here and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, this is about time that you take your walk with the Lord seriously and step into that grace.
Amen.
The rest God will take care of in due time. All he needed to do was just ask him to remember him. Can you say that to God today? Say, God, please remember me. Grace is good. The grace of God is good enough to take care of you. It's good enough to show kindness to you. It's good enough to restore you. It's good enough to give you abundant life. Amen? And ultimately, grace saves. Somebody say, grace saves. The grace of God saved this man. Are you gracious enough that it's actually causing and bringing salvation to people around you? I think we as a people, we should live our lives with full of grace and become so contagious, so infectious, like a cold in the winter. Like wherever you go, you cough a little bit, and that's grace. You cough, there is love. You cough, you empower people. You cough, you show generosity. Infect people. Infiltrate the world with the love of Jesus Christ. That's what we need to be doing. I know it sounds a bit gross, right? But that's the love of God. It's very infectious. Amen?
Amen.
And lastly, grace will cause you to live a selfless life. Grace will cause you to live a selfless life. If we go back to the video that we watched, it was either this man's son or a whole bunch of people going to hell. I'm still struggling with it because if it comes down to it, sacrifice my son Javen and a whole bunch of people on the TTC train, the train about to be derailed, Jesus help me. And it's actually harder in our time because of the fact that everything in our society is anti-God, anti-Christ. And you want me to sacrifice my son for you guys? Again, don't judge me. I'm just being real now. But I'm praying and hoping that one of these days God will give me the grace to be able to do that. But as I stand here right now, I'm struggling. As I'm speaking to you right now, I'm not speaking, preaching, I said, like, I can do it. I'm wrestling in my head. It's tough. But God did it. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only, only begotten son. Because that time that Jesus spent on the earth, I believe God could have been doing a whole lot of things with Jesus, creating different things and creating more galaxies and planets and creations and animals and doing different things. Like I can't wait to get to heaven because I really want to just be beside God and just create stuff with God. But for all these time, he forsook his glory to come on the face of the earth to die for you and I. And you take it for granted? I said, like, nothing ever happened. And in the end, when you look at that video, he's just watching these people pass by in the train. They look at him. And in his mind, he's probably thinking, do these people even know what I just did for them? And it's the same thing as people that we know in the world today. And we look at them like, do these people even know the God that I serve? Do they know what Jesus did for them? The price that he paid on the cross so that they can receive salvation. Same thing goes for you and the people that you love that you've been praying for that they will receive salvation. And they keep doing the same thing every now and then. Sometimes you feel like giving up, but you say, my God, do they know how much times I've gone on my knees and praying for them, praying and fasting and hoping that they will receive salvation, but they don't seem to get it. I'm tired. I'm about to give up on them. Yeah, sometimes you may feel like Jesus would say, Father, if it's all at all possible, let this cup pass. It's just human nature. Sometimes we feel that way. But you can't. Because the Apostle Paul puts it this way, my grace is sufficient. God's grace is sufficient to produce more love, produce more restoration. It's endless. And I really want to encourage you today, learn to live a gracious life. Amen?
Amen.
Sometimes you may pray for certain things God will not give you because he's being gracious to you. He could have given you what you deserve, but he's not giving it to you. Amen?
Amen.
We all have things that we go through in life. A lot of people in this world are searching left, right, and center. In the city of Toronto, some people are finding that, looking for that in drugs. Some are looking for that in sex, prostitution. Some are looking for that in psychics. They're looking for them in other gods. They're looking for them in relationships. They're looking for acceptance in families, looking for different things. But today I have a prophetic word for you. Some are going to prophets and paying a whole lot of money. Listen, any time somebody tells you to come give them money and they will give you a prophetic word or pray for you, please remember me. Amen? Seriously. I'm not trying to say I'm not special or anything. I'm no special than you or the other so-called prophet or whatever the case may be. But I believe, I'm a firm believer because I've experienced the word of God literally happening in my life. That if I'm able to teach you to walk in the ordinances of God, your needs will be met and you don't need any mystical stuff to happen in your life. It will happen as you walk out the word of God. And there are times God may give me a word to speak to you, but it doesn't happen all the time. And if it's not happening, I'm not going to force it and give it to you. But the prophetic word that I have for you today is that the grace of God is sufficient for you. Amen?
Amen.
Oh my God, somebody need this. You may be going through issues with your relationship, your marriage, but the prophetic word of God says, my grace is sufficient for you.
Amen.
You may be struggling with your finances, but the word of God says, my grace is sufficient. Why? Because he says, my God shall supply all my sins. This is Paul speaking, eh? So when you come and sow into my life, this is what the prophetic word I'll give you. My God, the God of Pastor Donald, shall supply all your needs. I'm not going to say pay $1,000 and I see, oh, you go in. No, I will give you the word. My God, because I believe in that word, shall supply all your needs according to his what? Riches and glory.
Amen.
I have a prophetic word for you. My grace is sufficient enough. The doctor diagnosed you with cancer and your tumor and it's growing and you're gonna have to start going to chemo. And that chemo, as a matter of fact, is gonna kill you. It's being researched. It kills you faster. But if you can learn to walk in the graciousness of God and begin to love your neighbor and forgive your neighbors, let go. By his stripes, you are healed. I'm not going to ask you to drink any water or just pour a whole bunch of oil on you and give you any spooky prophetic word. No. By his stripes, you are healed. My grace is sufficient for you. That is the prophetic word that you need to receive today. You are having suicidal thoughts. You want to kill yourself. Go to bed at night and you're thinking, man, all hope is lost. I don't know. I'm lonely. I feel like quitting this life because I don't know where I'm going. I'm stuck in this life. And it seems like I just can't keep working 9 to 5 and that's it. And we all know there is more. As believers, you know there is more. There is more. There is more. But you don't know where to turn. The prophetic word of God says, my grace is sufficient for you. But he goes on to say, I have come that you may have what? Life and life abundantly. So why are you acting like you don't have abundant life?
Amen.
Amen.
your journey of becoming all that God has predestined you to be. See, sometimes we worry so much because we run to all these places because we want to see the future and what people tell us about our future. Really and truly, it's great if you know, but what does it really do for you? He says, prophetic word, my grace is sufficient for you. But Jesus goes on to say, be anxious for
nothing.
And we are so anxious, wanting the prophets to tell us what's going to happen tomorrow and who is doing us and doing voodoo to us and Obia and all of that stuff. Why do you care? He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow. Are you in that secret place? If you're looking for those things, maybe you are not in that secret place.
Amen.
You are not abiding under the shadow of the Almighty. Somebody say, my grace,
my grace is
sufficient.
Sufficient.
We as a church, I believe that we will grow stronger and rapidly if we all, every single one of us, from the oldest to the youngest, begin to exercise grace at all times. Throughout the pages of the Holy Scriptures, God has always been reaching out to us. And he wants us for himself. But some of us, we are so consumed with ourselves, we don't want to give any part of ourselves to God. Let me challenge you this morning. Surrender it all to God. As a matter of fact, somebody just throw your hands up. Just wait to God. Say, God, I surrender. Come on. Just say, God, I surrender. God believes you enough to get it right. You will get it. It won't happen in a day. One thing I love about walking with God is the journey with God is an adventure. He will show me everything, and that is all right. I'm okay with that. Because he is a good God. He is Abba Father. He is a good Father. And I know he has good things. He said, if you men, earthly men, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more me, if you ask me for bread, will I give you a stone? If you ask me for fish, will I give you a serpent? Do you know your God? Do you know the Father you serve? Shall we rise to our feet?
This like every week, but would you like to ride to church with me? Oh, come on, Mrs. Edwards, you like my church. We have some hot music. It may not be what you're bumping at all, but it's hot. We get down. What do you say, Mrs. Edwards?
I suppose.
I've heard it said that 80% of first-time church visitors come because someone personally invited them. All people need to feel loved and wanted, and for some people, it just takes having someone offer to give them a ride to church. We have something great going on at this church. People's lives are being transformed by God's love. Your homework this week is to find at least one person who could use a little more of that love and invite them to come with you next week. Trust me, it's worth the extra effort.
Mrs. Edwards, you want to listen to some music on the way? Go ahead, your choice. Okay, here we are.